I want to set this right here for,
Patrick?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
April will be starting on vacation. She had like this unbelievable amount, but it starts in a couple of weeks.
Okay.
She's really anxious. She went through all that chemo, but
still,
she's really anxious. She said she's on a form or something, and she's seen women have been burned and gotten really bad sores and stuff from it, so
okay.
She's really concerned.
Anybody else? All right, let's begin with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you grateful for another day that you've given us, another week that you've allowed us to begin. We pray that we will show you our gratitude. We pray that we will use what you have given us in a way that is responsible. Here to open your word and to study it, we pray that we will continue to open our minds and allow your word to sink in, that we will take hold of it, that we will think and read and seriously on what you have desired for our relationship with us. Father, we pray that the word that you have given us, we pray that we will. We come to you, Heavenly Father, on behalf of those who need prayer this morning and might not be able to be with us. We pray that you would be with those who are dealing with physical injuries, or pray that you would be with chemo and the surgery, but she has more surgery and radiation that is coming. We pray that you carry her through that with as positive a health as with her. Pray that you would be with those of our who are scheduled for surgeries, or those who are recovering for surgeries, Heavenly Father, those who have chronic pain issues and that keep them from attending all of the things that perhaps they would like to attend. We pray that you would be with those who may be dealing with emotional problems, Heavenly Father, with mental issues. We pray that you would give them strength, that you would give them comfort, that you would allow us to have an opportunity to assist them, to be there for them. We pray, Father, that you would be with those this morning who have spiritual weaknesses. We pray that something will be said or done in their lives, that they will understand the importance of giving themselves to you, of being connected to the body, Heavenly Father, of getting back into your word and back into the work of your kingdom. We pray, Father, that all of those who are weak or struggling spiritually will continue to progress as long as they hold on to look towards you and your Son and continue to walk that life. Father, we pray that you would be with those who have been involved in Bible studies recently, those who have finished Bible studies. We pray that those who have not yet made the decision to obey will make that decision. We pray, Father, with those who are on the path of understanding and hearing your word, that they will hear it, that they will accept the truth, and they will obey the truth, Heavenly Father. We pray, Father, for those who are conducting Bible studies and those who are being involved in evangelism, that their efforts will be successful. Father, we thank you so much for all that you have done. We thank you most importantly for your Son, who you have given for us, his life, his death, Heavenly Father, his resurrection, giving us the freedom and the confidence to know that not only will our sins be forgiven, Heavenly Father, we have a path of salvation to you, but that you will continually be with us, Heavenly Father. We know that after baptism we still will fall, we will stumble, we will sin, and we thank you, Father, for the blood of your Son that continues to cover us. We pray, Father, that we all live in a way that is pleasing in your eyes. We will continually improve on the lives we are living before you, to remove those things that are roadblocks or unnecessary in our life that are keeping us from being the best Christians that we can be. And we pray, Father, that you would forgive us for the sins that we have committed, that we will make better decisions today and tomorrow if tomorrow comes. We pray all of these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, ma'am. What's that?
I said, we just want to thank God that this weekend I was at a wedding.
Oh, okay.
And a woman that got married.
Okay. I wasn't sure what you were telling me to start with. open our Bibles, if we haven't already, to the book of Isaiah. Chapter number 9. Chapter 9. Everybody there? Everybody on the same page? You ready? All right. It's situated real well between 8 and 10. If we begin looking at chapter 9 and verse 1, what incompleteness do we see to start with?
Despair.
Okay, what's the very first word?
Nevertheless.
How many stories start with nevertheless? Let's go back a couple of verses into chapter 8, understanding that mankind, for ease of reading, for reference, has placed chapter and verses, and let's get a little bit more of an understanding of what it is we're discussing. Verse 19. Now, verse 19 in chapter 8 follows what God told Isaiah. Anybody from last week remember what God was telling him here? Don't walk in the way of the people. Don't think the way of the people. Don't speak as the people speak. And when they say to you, verse 19, seek those who are mediums and wizards, who whisper and mutter. Should not a people seek their God? Should they seek the dead on behalf of the living? To the law of testimony. If they do not speak according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. They will pass through it hard pressed and hungry. It shall happen when they are hungry that they will be enraged and curse their king and their God and look upward. Then they will look to the earth and see trouble and darkness, gloom and anguish into darkness. So the end of chapter 8 is of no argument that it's very dark, right? It's very gloomy. It is full of despair. There is nothing but negativity and punishment that is there. Now, that negativity, why? It wasn't God's arbitrary decision. It was because of their foolishness. It was because of their refusal to obey God. It was because of their refusal to listen to the words of the Almighty. They had heard for generation after generation what God had done. Remember when Joshua took the people into that promised land? God rolled back the waters, held back the waters, allowed them to cross over. After they crossed over, what was one of the first things they did? Anybody? They built it. They built a monument. For what purpose? To remind them of what God had done. Not only do they have that kind of reminder, but they have these narratives, these accounts. I don't love using the word stories, but if you use the word stories, passed down from generation to generation. God took us away from Egypt. God took us into this land. God parted the Red Seas. God held back the Jordan River. God gave us manna. God gave us quail. God, all in all, you have so many of these accounts where through generations you can see what God had done for them. Even if you get closer to this time, you say, well, that was all the way back in Exodus. That was a long time ago. Well, in the book of Judges, as they go into the promised land, what happens? They march around the city of Jericho and God caused the walls to fall flat. In Judges chapter 6, 7, and 8, Gideon goes and takes with him a very small number of people. And God allows them to have a victory, provides for them a victory of 300 versus 135,000 Midianites. When you go through some more of the kings, you get into Saul, and then you get into David. You've got this victory over Goliath. God has continually been with them. And yet, what did they do? Saul would be a great case study for this. Instead of turning to God, what did Saul do? Remember one day Saul went to somebody. Saul didn't want anybody to know he was there. Saul is maybe hiding under some kind of a cloak, hoping nobody recognizes him. Saul wants to go and he wants to find one of these so-called mediums. He wants to find somebody that can connect him with somebody that has already passed on. We don't have time to talk about that too deeply this morning, but I do think there is some comedy in that it's almost as if that person is surprised that Samuel actually shows up. I can't imagine the fear that individual and that Saul must have experienced at that moment. Point being, God's people had years, not just 5, not just 10, but hundreds of years of proof of God's power, of God's providence, and of God's protection. And still, what did they do? They still wanted false prophets, they wanted spiritists or wizards, these mediums, and they still wanted these fake gods. After being shown many times they didn't have the power to do anything, what about 1 Kings 18? What was the difference between these prophets of Baal and what they were able to get their so-called little g god to do and what Elijah was able to do? They cut themselves, they danced around, they cried for half the day almost. Nothing happened. So much so that Elijah kind of poked them a little bit, right? What did he say? Yell louder. Maybe your God's on a journey. Maybe he can't hear you. And yet, as soon as Elijah called on God, God answered immediately. And these people still wouldn't learn their lesson. God tells Isaiah in chapter 8, don't be like them. God had shown his long suffering in that God's people, after he had called them out of Egypt, how often? I'm not looking for a specific number, just in generality. How often had God's people forsaken him, stumbled before him, and decided to follow somebody else? Almost the entire time, right? Off and on from the entire time. Although God clearly shows his power, they continually turn over and they want to intermingle with the people who lived in that land, and they want to offer their obeisance and offer their worship to wood or stone that a man carved and then a man attributed to them some kind of special powers when they could do nothing at all. Didn't one of those little g gods have a bad day when the Ark of the Covenant was close to them? They come in and what happened to it? It fell over. So when you're looking at when God's talking about this despair, this is not a decision that God made on the spur of the moment. This is a decision that God is handing down on his people. He does not delight in punishing them. The book of Ezekiel tells us that, right? God doesn't enjoy the death of the wicked. The New Testament tells us God wants everybody to hear the truth. God wants everybody to be saved. God wants everybody to follow him. But his people had stressed him and had stretched his long-suffering for so many years now, he finally allows them Forgive me for saying that. I didn't mean to say that. God finally allows them to reach the end that he acknowledges they're going to finalize themselves into. God has called them. God has begged them. God has provided for them. He has sent them prophets. And what's the end result? They just don't care. They aren't moved by it. They simply are not interested. So what does God do? How does God do it? We talked about this before, that at least one of God's prophets was very surprised at God's answer. Now we know Isaiah, this book tells us that God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. God's ways are higher than our ways. How was God going to bring about punishment on his people?
Through Assyria.
Through these other nations, through pagans, through heathens. It was going to be the Assyrians. It was going to be the Babylonians. And we've talked before about Habakkuk having this grand kind of exclamation before God. So how can you use wicked people to conquer your people, essentially? Where would the understanding need to come from the standpoint of Habakkuk? If you're using wicked people to punish God's people, you might in your mind get that all twisted up, but what was God actually doing? God was using wicked people to punish wicked people. That's what was actually happening. And then on top of that, don't worry about the Assyrians. They'll be taken care of. Don't worry about the Babylonians. They'll be taken care of. Everyone who lives in a way that is opposite to what God has set forth will receive this form of punishment. So we begin in chapter 9, verse 1. knowing what's going to happen, knowing the future that's coming, nevertheless. What does nevertheless mean? That's one of those words that we know what it means, but we can't put it into words, right? Let's go ahead and read verses 1 through 7. We'll take turns reading 2, 3, 4, whatever verses apiece, so somebody doesn't read it all by themselves. Verses 1 to 7. Want to start in verse 3:6-7.
For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called the Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, and to establish it with judgment and with the justice from henceforth. Even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.
Okay. Let's go ahead and go back, and we'll start looking there at verse 1. Let's go back to the nevertheless. Chapter 8 certainly closed with this message of distress and gloom. But chapter 9 opens up with a brand new day. Now, the overarching message, I'm sure we are very familiar with verses 6 and 7, right? The overarching message is a projection toward and a prediction of what? Right, so this is very clearly a messianic section of Scripture, pointing forward to the Messiah. Let's go back and look. Nevertheless, the gloom will not be upon her who is distressed. Different translations translate that somewhat differently. There is at least one translation that makes that somewhat more clear, perhaps, than the King James and New King James, and the impression given in the first half of verse 1 is they were in gloom, they were in distress, they were lightly esteemed, but they have better days that will come. They endured hard times before, but better days will come. Zebulun and Naphtali are mentioned in the first verse. These were tribal territories north of Mount Carmel and west of the Sea of Galilee. These areas contained a mixed population in Isaiah's day, which could allow them to have been designated as Galilee of the Gentiles. Now, when we think of the word Galilee, what kind of things come to mind? Sorry? Sea of Galilee, okay. I saw some pictures of that recently. A friend of mine went over to a trip there in Israel. He actually stayed in Israel longer than he wanted to, because while he was over there and he was about to leave, some of them tested positive for COVID. So he was really upset that he was in Israel, but couldn't explore Israel because he's in quarantine. But he took some pictures and sent us. I've got three or four pictures that he sent from the Sea of Galilee. I can imagine that would be really great at making an impression on you if you could stand in front of the water where you knew so much of Jesus's activity and the apostles' activity had taken place. What else comes to mind when you think of Galilee? In what way was Galilee used negatively? Anybody? Think about the book of John. Think about Nicodemus attempting to protect Jesus in front of the other leaders, and he said, "Does our law judge a man without listening to him first?" What was their response to him? Anybody remember? Does our law judge a man before it hears him and knows what he is doing? They answered and said to him, Are you also from Galilee? Search and look, for no prophet has arisen out of Galilee. Now, even that in itself was not a correct statement. I believe there's at least one Old Testament prophet that did come from the region of Galilee. But what kind of impression was being made there? Are you also from Galilee? See, our importance is the city of David, right? Our importance is the temple. Our importance is the Temple Mount. We think about the importance and the prophecy that pertains to Bethlehem, right? Because that's where the Messiah is going to come from. Where's the interest in Galilee?
Jesus lived in Nazareth.
Okay.
Where
do you think Nazareth was located? Galilee.
Jesus called the Galileans.
Well, and you look at, it's interesting too, the New Testament speaks of that he will be called a Nazarene. We don't have time to go into that too deeply this morning, but the idea there was that those terms, specifically Nazarene, those terms would be used negatively. What about Peter? After Jesus told Peter that he was going to deny him three times, what was one of the responses that the people gave to Peter to attempt to prove their assumption of who he was?
Right.
The way that he spoke. Let me go turn over. It's interesting. In verse 69, this is in Matthew. This is just one of the accounts. In verse 69... the servant girl said, You also were with Jesus of Galilee. And then in verse 71, this fellow also was with Jesus of Nazareth. And then in verse 73, certainly for you are one of them, for your speech betrays you. Let me go look at this other account very quickly, and then we're going to get back to Isaiah. Then after about an hour had passed, this is in Luke 22. After about an hour had passed, another confidently affirmed, saying, Surely this fellow also is with him, for he is a Galilean. So you certainly look at the central understanding of where some of these Jews, their assumption of Jesus was that he was, I mean, very much so an outsider. Now we know what the Jews in Jesus' day thought of the Samaritans, but does it really look like they had much higher of an opinion of the Galileans? Not at all. And we know that that's where Jesus was born, in Bethlehem. But Jesus lived his life, most of his life, in Nazareth. And then Jesus essentially shifted his home base when he began his earthly ministry from Nazareth to Capernaum. Of course, that much closer to the sea. And there's certainly a lot of what Jesus did that was around this Galilean region. So as you look at what's taking place here, Zebulun and Naphtali, we know that verses 6 and 7 in Isaiah chapter 9 are messianic. What conclusion can we make at the very beginning of the chapter? Do these verses sound familiar? A new idea of Gentile involvement in the time of hope might be addressed here in verse number 1. The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward more heavily oppressed her by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan in Galilee of the Gentiles. Now pay very close attention, and I want you to remember your the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. Now we've talked before about a prophetic perfect. Anybody remember what we've said before in regards to prophetic perfect? Prophetic perfect is when something is written in the past, well before something takes place, but it is written in a way as if it has already happened. For instance, Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 intends to impress upon us that the Lord will die for us, that the Lord will bear our sins. Why is it a will? Because Isaiah is written over 700 years before Jesus was born. But does Isaiah 53 say he will bear our sins or he will die for us? What's the language of Isaiah 53 say? I'm going to turn over there real quickly for you. Isaiah 53, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. So how's the chapter written? The chapter is written 700 years before Jesus was born, before Jesus came to earth in the form of a man. 700 years before he's going to give his life for us, and by his stripes we would be healed. But it's written in Isaiah like it's already taken place, like it's already happened. That's the idea of prophetic perfect, where God gives us a prophecy of something that will happen in the future, but he writes it as if it has already happened. Now, what's the purpose in that? It is an absolute confirmation and surety that this is going to happen and nothing can change it, because God's writing about something that's in the future as if it's in the past. This is the idea of prophetic perfect. Where do you see that here in Isaiah chapter 9? Look at verse 2. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. It's the same thing, right? We're talking about something far off in the future, but writing it as if it has already happened. What's the idea of light in the Bible? What's the easy contrast between dark and light? Good and evil. Okay, we think about John chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. The darkness hates the light because the light exposes its deeds. If you go right to John chapter 1, what's one of the first things you see? We know that he was in the world in the flesh later on, but he was also in the beginning before the world, right? In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Down to verse 4, it says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. He still doesn't stop there. Verse 7, this man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light. So John, the baptizer, is coming to witness and prepare for the light, that all through him might believe. It said, John was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. You can also write down, if you'd like to take notes, John 8 and verse 12. One commentator said, the whole work of Christ and all the blessings which he brings may be characterized by one word, and that is light. How would you characterize all that Jesus is by light? Think about an image that's given to us in the last two chapters of the book of Revelation. Why is there no need for sun or moon in the vision that John was given of heaven? Because the Lamb is the light. Okay? So this theme of Jesus and light, we have from the beginning of his life until the time at which everyone has taken part of that their final home in eternity. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 4. Maybe you already know this. Maybe your mind has already had some bells go off, but I want to make this connection for you if you haven't already seen it. The contents of Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 and 2 are not read only one time in the Bible. Matthew chapter 4, if you'd like to take down notes, write down Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 to 16. He departed to Galilee, and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, anybody know what we're about to read? Chapter 9, right? The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. People who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What is the necessity, the benefit, the profit of us reading the Old Testament and the New Testament? Is it likely that sometimes our Old Testament pages can be a little cleaner and crisper and newer and whiter than our, our New Testament pages, because we say, well, the New Testament is what governs us today. The New Testament is the covenant that we've got, that is this new covenant. It's the law of Christ. It's the teaching of Christ. It teaches us grace and mercy and the information and instructions by which we must be saved, and that's all true. But I am very much so of the opinion that you will never understand the New Testament the way that you can. And you will never understand the New Testament as well as possible without reading the Old Testament. You've got to spend time in the Old Testament. The things that were written before time, what did Paul say? Were written for our learning, so that we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope. What does that mean? What are you able to do when you read here in Isaiah 9 and you're not really sure what's happening here? Well, when I turn over to Matthew chapter 4, if I'm curious, I say, well, maybe this is about Jesus. Maybe I didn't have a clue at all. What does Matthew 4 tell me? The Spirit, through Matthew's pen, tells me that these two verses in Isaiah 9 is absolutely talking about Jesus, and specifically when? When Jesus begins his earthly ministry and begins teaching in that region of the world. And so then when I put those two verses together, then what does that do as I continue to read through the Old Testament? I look at all of the preparation that's taking place in the Old Testament. I look at all of these keys, all of these things that had been hidden in plain sight through the previous 1,000+ years that the New Testament begins to shine all of that light on. And you see a perfect agreement that exists between the two. And there's a lot of historical and cultural information that helps us to understand some that's taking place. All right, let's go back and look. It very clearly is this messianic prophecy. We understand what's taking place. Verse 3, you have multiplied the nation, back in Isaiah 9. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. This verse shows the result of the issuing of the light that is mentioned in verses 1 and 2. Gladness and rejoicing will be seen in a bountiful harvest or in a victory over one's enemies. Is there any increasing of joy or rejoicing that would be greater than the time of life of the world, of the unfolding of God's plan that's taking place when verses 1 and 2 come to light? Because all these other things have been looking forward to something, right? Galatians chapter 3 tells us that the old law was bringing us as a tutor up until the time of Christ, and the time of Christ and the time of faith. Then we have this finality of God's plan being delivered to us. We know what the Scripture says. This has always been God's plan, but it had to play out over these thousands of years. And Isaiah 9 begins to tell us when that's going to happen. Verse 3 in chapter 9 is the result of that. Verse 4, it says, for you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as is in the day of Midian. Commentators indicate there could be two historical references that could be taking place here in verse 4. Number one could recall the Egyptian bondage, reflected in the words yoke, burden, shoulders, and oppressor. The other might refer to the defeat of Midian, as recorded in Judges 6, 7, and 8. And again, I mentioned that when we started just a couple of minutes ago. If you put the numbers together in Judges, I believe it's in Judges 7 and 8, and you look at all that's there, what's the imagery of that? I'll call it a battle, but it wasn't really a battle. What's the imagery? What are the numbers on either side? Anybody remember? You put all of that together, you've got 135,000 Midianites, and how many of God's people? You just got 300. Now, in what world, without God's assistance, is that 300 going to survive for more than 5 minutes? I mean, we're not talking about 300 versus 3,000. We're not talking about 300 versus 30,000. 300 versus 135,000. Think of how many times they would be outnumbered, outmatched, and multiplied onto, and yet God gives them that victory. God frees them from that. We know that when God went and found Gideon and called him to work, where was he? He was hiding, wasn't he? He was trying to keep what he was doing from the Midianites. Well, so if you're connecting this to the victory God had given them over Midian, what other assumption might you take when you look at verse 4? You have broken the yoke of his burden the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as is in the day of Midian. Well, if verses 1 and 2 are messianic, and verses 6 or 7 are messianic, what kind of clues might you see in verses 3, 4, and 5?
What's messianic?
In reference to Jesus, the Messiah. So when we see these types of prophecies, they are pointing toward to the time of Jesus, whether he's called Lord, whether he's called Messiah, whether he's called Rabbi, whether he's called Jesus. There's a variety of names that Jesus is going to be called by or referenced to. But specifically, we're talking about Messiah, which, you know, Messiah in Hebrew is Christ in English. And so when you're looking at this Messiah, this Savior that is to come, all of these references of the Old Testament that project to that time he's coming are just referred to as these messianic types of prophecies because they relate to him. So what do you see in verses 3, 4, and 5? What burden would be broken off of the shoulders of the world by this light shining in Galilee? Sin. Is there any burden bigger than sin? Surely there's not. And are we capable of doing anything about that burden ourselves? Absolutely not. It's only something that the Lord can do for us. Verse 5, for every warrior's sandal, that word could also mean boot, warrior and sandal, might not make common sense to us today, but we could understand at the time in which it was written that might make good sense. Every warrior's sandal from the noisy battle and garments rolled in blood will be used for burning and fuel of fire. You're looking at this great victory there that is being given. All right, now, verses 6 and 7, we are very familiar with these words and phrases. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Now this certainly has very quick reference in our minds of studying Isaiah to what? Chapter 7, right? Chapter 7 and verse 14, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel, which the New Testament tells us is translated God with us. Unto us a child is born, verse 6 of chapter 9, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Okay? Have you ever spent any time thinking about what all of these different things referencing him might mean? What kind of application they might have? Let me mention a couple of things for you. We're looking at this ruler from the line of David, a point that certainly was going to be emphasized in Scripture. The language used here indicates that he's going to be seen in a different way of those coming from that natural line, right? If you'd like notes, write down Matthew 22, 42 to 44. Now let's go through some of these words very quickly. We've got about 4 minutes left, so we'll be able to look at verses 6 and 7. The word wonderful is often used in the Old Testament to describe those things associated with God that are unusual, supernatural, and extraordinary. The word counselor means to, as you might assume, to advise or counsel. Could also carry, though, the idea of guidance as a shepherd. Write down Psalm 23 and John chapter 10. Calling him Mighty God points to his divinity, that he is a part of God. We know from Philippians chapter 2 that he left equality in heaven to come down here and take on the form of a man to humble himself and be obedient to that death. But we know that he was God, is God, always will be God, was there at the beginning with God before anything was created. Genesis chapter 1, God said, let what? Us make man in our image, okay? I'm going to give you some verses if you want to take down some notes. The mighty God pointing to his divinity. John chapter 1 and verse 1, which is perhaps one of the most popular that we would turn to. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Romans 9 and verse 5. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 1. Romans 9 and verse 5. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Revelation 21, 6 and 7. And Revelation 22 and 16. verses to go to if you have a conversation with someone, for you to go and prepare yourself to present these, because you still may have a conversation with someone who is of the opinion that Jesus is not who he said he was. In the religious world, there is still a division amongst some. Some believe, as the Bible teaches, and as we know to be true, that Jesus is God. Some people don't believe that. Some people have given their minds over to thinking of Jesus as being lesser than that. The Bible has some very strong, some harsh words of correction to say regarding that. Yes, ma'am.
What verse did you say
for Revelation? Revelation 21, 6 and 7. And 22, 16. All right, Everlasting Father is used. Now, this one is interesting to me. We know that Jesus is God. We also think about God being in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. What's the importance here then of Everlasting Father being used as a reference in verse 6 to what we know to be a messianic prophecy? One indicated that the quality of fatherhood is defined by the word everlasting or eternal. That's one of the things that we're really looking at here in Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. We're looking at a word that is a combination of that which is in this position or that which is a father, but the word that follows it means essentially from now on, for eternity, for all of this time. And so the impetus that this word and this phrase has is indicating a position of this blessedness, of this authority, of this sovereignty and superiority that is unmatched and that is never going to end. In Old Testament, God is called Father 8 times and compared to a father in 7 additional verses. The fatherhood of God is much more prevalent in the New Testament, particularly in the words of Jesus. This word is a compound word, the word we see here for Everlasting Father. And this is just my personal conclusions, my personal thoughts. I cannot go to the Bible and prove this to you, but I'm curious if perhaps this is the way this phrase was used. I can't help but wonder if this Everlasting Father phrase is attributed to Jesus, because we know that it is Jesus. Now, not everybody knows this. It may be a surprise to some people, but it is Jesus that created everything that we see now. We know that God did it, but we said that God did it through Jesus. And of course, Jesus is God. So perhaps this phrase has reference to Jesus being the beginning of creation, Revelation 3:14. Jesus also began something else, did he not? Jesus was the firstborn from the dead, so perhaps this phrase also has a reference to his being the author of salvation or the archetype of it, Hebrews 12:1-2. And very lastly, we're already a minute over time. We'll finish this. Prince of Peace. The word peace is usually more than usually thought. We assume peace, we assume calmness, but the Hebrew word of peace is much more than just calmness. It's much more than just agreement. It's much more than just nobody's fighting or arguing. The idea of the Hebrew word shalom brings with it the idea of soundness or wholeness, even health in it. It's not just peace. It's a much farther reaching word than just peace. Someone has said that peace is not the absence of trouble, but the presence of God. Write down, if you want, Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. All right, we do not have time to discuss all of this section. We're going to have to leave verse 7. Now, we have a gospel meeting starting next week, so we're going to have to leave verse 7 for 2 weeks. So try to keep this in your mind as much as possible. But Lord willing, we will come back in 2 weeks, and we will begin in verse 7. And we will talk about the strength and the days attributed to the kingdom, and we'll reference another Old Testament scripture. But as far as this morning, we're out of time.
Good morning. It's time to begin worship service. Good morning. Thank you. think he's looking for mama. Say greetings to everyone. As always, we are thankful to God for everyone who's in attendance this morning. We ask if you have a cell phone, we ask that you please turn it off and place it on mute in order not to disturb the worship service. For those members watching on Facebook, please hit like so we know that you are with us. And if you are visiting with us, we want you to know that we're glad that you're in attendance this morning, and we want you to know as well that you are our honored guest. And we ask that if you are visiting with us, to please just linger a bit so in order for the congregation, the members here, can get to know you a little better. We do have a nursery or training room available. If you have need of those rooms, please exit the auditorium, and one of the brethren will direct you to that location. On our sick and loved ones, we ask that you keep Brenda Sellers' mother. She's back in the hospital with fluids around her lungs and stomach. Brenda also said that this morning she's really not doing well at all. She has COVID. They did drain some fluid around her heart. As a result of them draining fluid around her heart, she went in AFib. So she is really having some heart complications. So please keep Brenda Sellers' mother in prayer. Also, Rodney Carter's mother-in-law, Betty Martin, was believed to have a stroke, but it was just blood pressure. But please continue to keep Betty Martin in prayer as well. Jim Dukes is battling health issues. He had a blood work done on Friday, but continue to keep Brother Dukes in prayer. Mary Lou Danes is requesting prayers for her brother who will have back surgery, and that will be happening tomorrow. So please keep them in prayer. In our other announcements, our gospel meeting, join us for our summer gospel meeting from June 19th to June 22nd. We will have a different speaker each day. Please share the flyers in the foyer. It's on Facebook and it's on our website to share as well. We would also have fellowship luncheon following the morning service in the fellowship hall. Bring casseroles, meat dishes, vegetables, desserts, and kitchen group 4, the teen class, will have kitchen duties for that day. I want to encourage everyone as well to please mark your calendars and come out and attend our gospel meeting. The elders we have a speaker each night, but the elders looked at the subjects that they were going to speak in, and we feel that these subjects are going to be very beneficial to the congregation. And we ask that you please come out and be in attendance. The first day, we're going to have Reinforce My Foundation by Cody Westbrook, Restore My Spirit by Cody Westbrook. Sometimes, we all in life, we go through difficulties. And sometimes, even at our best efforts, we need our spirit restored. On Monday, There's Nothing Wrong with My Church. Tuesday, What is Truth? Al Washington. Wednesday, Blueprint of Church Growth. So a lot of good subjects, and they will be beneficial to you. So please, the elders would like everybody to come and attend each night of our meeting. Singing practice. Join us for our singing practice on Wednesday, June 15th at 6 p.m. here at the building. Pep night, on our next pep night is June the 17th at 6 p.m. in the fellowship hall. Men's bowling fellowship. There will be a men's bowling fellowship on Saturday, June 18th. At 12 p.m. at the Hallmark Lanes Bowling Alley. Save the dates on July 31st, August 3rd, and join us for our vacation Bible school. Sign up sheets for teachers, teachers aides, teachers help, and cookies are in the foyer. So if you haven't never participated in the VBS, we would like to encourage everyone to sign up and participate in our VBS. Sunny Glen Children's Home on Sunny Glen Children's Home Drive is underway through July 10th. The items requested are ketchup, mustard, mayo, kids' cereal, mashed potato mix, hamburger helper. A take-home list is posted in the foyer and items will be placed in the box below it. Ladies' breakfast and work day plus Japanese flower arrangement class. There will be a ladies' breakfast and work day with a Japanese flower arrangement class on Saturday, June the 25th at 9:30 a.m. in the fellowship hall. Please bring clippers and or vase with a narrow opening. More details are posted on the ladies' bulletin board. I do have a card to read this morning. It is from Yvonne Ray Hardiman. She says, thank you for all your prayers and your generous heart. Thank you so much. Our order service this morning, Paul Portley will have our song service. First prayer will be Daryl Higginbotham. Sermon will be Phil McIntosh. Communion will be Andre Pettaway and Gianni Griffith. And closing prayer will be Scott Davis. Let us begin our worship service.
Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that we can come here the first day of the week to offer our blessings, to ask for your blessings upon us, that through Christ he came and he died for us. He paid the ultimate that we may have forgiveness of sins, and we ask that you be with us as we go through this worship service this morning and believe those things that we read in the Bible, believe the history of the Jewish people, the sacrifices, the sayings of the different ones that gave us the Bible. We ask that you be with us as we begin our song service, that we pay attention to the words themselves, that the love of Jesus, that's what he gave to us, the love of his ministry, that we may show this love to our neighbors and our friends, and may we seek those things out that will benefit those. A number of our people are sick. They've been numbered this morning, and we ask that you be with them and comfort, and may those things be done that will relieve their pain and suffering. There's a lot of pain and suffering taking place all over the world. Ukraine is one of the worst places right now that people are desperate. There's no real relief in sight. We ask that you be with them, be with our Christian friends that are there, that are suffering. May we do those things that will benefit, whether it be physical things, clothing or food, whatever it might be, that we will see their need and try to take care of them. Of course, this morning we're here to remember our son Jesus, to remember the life, the love that he shed for us through the sacrifice that we may have forgiveness of sins. We need to ask you in his name for forgiveness of our sins. We ask that you be with us through this service this morning. May the songs of praise be heard, and may we be benefit from them. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Brother Galen William was scheduled to lead singing this morning, but he and his family are sick. Let's keep them in our prayers. As Brother Hickenbacher mentioned already, our song service is an act of worship. And as we sing these songs, let's not only concentrate on the melody, but also the words that we're singing. They are very important as we give honor to God. Number 138. If you wouldn't mind, if you're able to, let's stand together. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust his sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up because they had no depthness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. And others fell on into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold.
Number 616. I'm satisfied with just cut below a little silver, a little gold, but in the
shine. I want a gold one, the silver line. I'm gonna mention just over the hilltop in the bright land where we'll never grow. And someday yonder we'll never move under, but walk the street that are pure as gold. Oh, often tempted, tormented and tested, and like a prophet, my pillow is stone. And though I find here no permanent dwelling, I know he'll hear me a measure. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow. And someday yonder we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are pure as gold. Don't think me poor, deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a robe and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in the bright land where we'll never grow. And someday yonder we'll never move on, but walk the streets that are pure as gold.
The song of encouragement is number 101. Number 101, I surrender all. Mark that selection, we'll sing at the proper time. Let's see.
To get the microphone turned on. Lord willing, next Sunday morning, we will begin our gospel meeting for the youth. Certainly want to encourage everyone who has the opportunity to make plans to be here for that gospel meeting, for all of the days of a gospel meeting. Not only will our topics be different, but also our speakers will be different, having four different men come in and who have agreed to deliver us lessons from God's Word. If you haven't yet taken the opportunity, go on the church's website or Facebook or in your Monday morning emails and take the picture that is there at the flyer of the gospel meeting and send that to family, friends, neighbors, co-workers, or anybody else who lives close enough who would be able to come and to attend that meeting. The theme of that meeting is an abundant life. We'll hear lessons that has to deal with the spiritual health of those who are gathered here on a weekly basis, those who make up the body of the Lord's Church who meets here at 400 North W.S. Young, but also the spiritual health of those in the community around us, the spiritual health of those who might not understand, might not be aware of the spiritual health that is holding them back from who they could be in this life, that is keeping them from that life. Jesus says in John chapter 10 and verse 10 that he has come to give us an abundant life, and so many people aren't living an abundant life. So many people are holding on. So many people are scraping by. So many people are disillusioned with what this world has to offer, and they certainly must feel that there is something else out there, yet they have not attained to it, and perhaps that's because they have never been told, or they have never opened for themselves the Word and found where that source of that abundant life is. Sometimes it's that people are disinterested. Sometimes it's that some people just don't know. Let me read for you a verse very quickly from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Those of us who do know the contents of and the blessings of that abundant life that comes from the Lord need to take it upon ourselves not just to wait on the elders, not just to wait on the preacher, but take it a personal responsibility and goal within our life to take that word into the world and to let those around us know that there is something better than what they're dealing with on a daily basis. There's something better for them out there. There's a better way to live. You don't have to just scrape by. There is a way to overcome. There is a way to thrive and not just survive and barely by the skin of our teeth make it into the next day. Those are some of the things that perhaps we'll be able to discuss next week in our gospel meeting in this abundant life. Sometimes when you gather together at the worship service on a Sunday morning, you hear a lesson, and that lesson might not always have wonderful application to you because we are very different people. Not all of us are teenagers. Not all of us are of a seasoned age. It's funny, isn't it? The older you get, what constitutes a seasoned age seems to get older. Whenever I was a teenager, 30 and 40 was pretty seasoned. 30 and 40 was pretty out there. I'm not going to tell you what seasoned means to me today, but I'm assuming that number will probably change in about 15 years. Lord willing, I'm able to live that long. But we all have these different experiences, and life is very different for someone who is 15 or 85. Life is very different from somebody who's 25 or 55. We all are at various points and stages of development and experience within our lives. Not all of us are married. Not all of us are men. Not all of us are women. So sometimes when we have lessons that are very specific and narrowed in their focus, some of us might struggle to pay attention to all that that lesson has to say because we might think, well, that really doesn't have a lot of application to me. Well, that's not the case this morning. So everybody has the opportunity to make sure you are awake, alert, taking notes either mentally or physically, and you should be able, regardless of your age, life situation, stage of life, of development in which you are in, education level, gender, education, progression, it doesn't matter. Everybody should be able to take something from our lesson today, apply it to their life, and hopefully improve on that abundant life that they are from Jesus right now living. I don't think any of us could ever say that we have become all we can be for God. None of us would say that we have attained to everything we could be. None of us would say that we know enough or have done enough at this point, that we are close enough to God. I'll just be able to be okay right here. I'll just take this seat on this train and I'll just ride the rest of the way into heaven. We may be nibbling on that abundant life that the Lord has provided for us, but there's still more that we can do. There's more to that bread. There's more to that water that He has promised us. Part of my responsibility is to take this word and to present it to you in a way when I have the opportunities that you can digest it, that you'll be willing to ingest it, and that you will be able to use it in your life. One of Paul's goals that he wrote to the church that met in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 28 was talking about Jesus, and he said, whom we preach and who we teach, we warn every man and teach every man. For what purpose, Paul? So that every man may be presented perfect in Christ Jesus. Now, as you come here on a Sunday morning, we meet for about an hour and 15 minutes or so, give or take 10 minutes. You listen to the scriptures, we open our words, and we begin to look at the information, the instruction, the plea that God has given to each one of us. Our goal is so much more than to just come here for 35 minutes or come here for 40 minutes of a sermon and then to go home. I'd like to leave you with something, leave you with an impression from the word this morning that you can use in your life that will impact you more than just Sunday morning. Some of you I see multiple times a week. Some of you I might only see once a week. And for that once a week, it is for less than 2 hours of time. So I want to impress upon you what the scripture has to say, that it can provide you for your life, and hope that you will take this and do something positive with it. This morning we're going to talk about planting and sowing, the produce that comes from it, and our role in this exercise. You don't have to raise your hands, just think about this for yourself. How many of us are good at gardening? Anybody here have ever been accused of having a green thumb? You know, you can grow anything, everything's always positive. Maybe there are some of us here this morning that can make tomatoes grow to the size of softballs. Maybe there are some of us here this morning that could kill a plastic ficus. Some of us are just not very good when it comes to plants. Some of us might be very good. I would appreciate and show appreciation for anything that anybody gave to my family, because it was the thought behind the gift that matters. But if you have the opportunity to think beforehand, if you were ever to give something to me or my wife, please don't give us a plant. It will die. It will not live in our house for very long. We're not very good at that. We're okay with our kids. They're still pretty healthy. Mother-in-law's still over there. But plants, you know, they're way down the list, and plants don't always make it real long in our house. Maybe you know what that's like. Maybe you're good at plants. Maybe you wish nobody would give you a plant either. But we understand how the idea of planting goes. If there is not good soil, if there's not good nourishment, if there's not attention paid to it, it's not going to last very long. The Bible tells us that there are two different types of plants that exist in this world. In Matthew chapter 13, verses 36 to 39, Jesus tells us that these two plants, one has been planted by the Lord, and the other has been planted by the devil. These two plants will grow together in this world and will coexist until the end of the world comes. Jesus has given us a picture of the world as that which is this grand field with two separate plants living in it, living amongst each other. That's not the only time that he mentions planting, though, but we're going to talk about these two types of plants. We're going to talk about these different types of soils as we look earlier in the book of Matthew chapter 13. And we're going to discuss what type of soil we are. And I want you to think as we go throughout this lesson, if your answer to the type of soil you are is not what you want it to be, you have the freedom to change that before it's too late. There's only two points this morning. They both start with the first letter of P, if you're taking notes. So let's discuss the parable, starts with P, parable of the soils. Now maybe as you open to Matthew chapter 13, you speak of this in a different way. Maybe you call it the parable of the seed. Maybe you call it the parable of the sower. Maybe you call it the parable of the soils. Whatever name you give to that, let's go ahead and open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 13. As you get into the New Testament, you see a type of teaching that is unique to Jesus. As you look at all of the other teachings and the writings of the Old and New Testament, Jesus speaks in a way that is a little obscure to those who are not used to it, but he speaks in what we know to be parables that are essentially word picture sermons that allow people with elements they can understand to take in, to digest, and to be able to have the ability to apply something that he is saying. He often says that the kingdom of heaven is like this. And then he describes it with something that they would know, something that they would be familiar with, something that they would understand. Jesus explained why he taught in parables here in Matthew chapter 13, verses 10 through 16. He quotes Isaiah chapter 6, and he essentially speaks of two different types of people that would hear him. The first type of person would be disinterested. The first type of person would be unmoved or unimpressed by what he had to say. They would hear his words and they would simply go on about their life. The second type of person, though, would be inclined to improve their spiritual life. They would listen to what he had to say. They would dig in deep, try to hold on to what he has given them, and to use it some way in their lives. Those who had a curiosity of what Jesus meant would come to him afterwards and ask him, "Lord, what did you mean by this? Lord, what are we to understand from this? What are we to take from this?" Those who were unmoved and unimpressed, though, would simply go about their lives and forget about his teaching, perhaps. I want you to read these verses with me. Matthew chapter 13, beginning in verse 1. On the same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the sea. And great multitudes were gathered together to him, so that he got into a boat and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. Then he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them. Some fell on stony places where they did not have much earth, and they immediately sprang up because they had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. But others fell on good ground and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Those who are interested in what he's really saying, let him digest these words. Now, there is relatively easy application if you were to look at this. Perhaps you need a little bit of assistance if this is the first time that you've come along this type of a reading. But speaking of this in just pure physical, earthly, material forms, you understand that not every ground is going to take a seed. Not every ground is going to produce the same way. Some are going to be more fertile. Some are going to be more apt to be receptive to a particular type of seed. Some places you can grow almost anything, and some places you can't grow anything. That's just how it is. That's just the way those soils are. That's the way that that environment is. And depending on the environment and the nourishment, it's going to dictate what happens with that produce, whether it produces or not. Now, before we actually get into the parable and the application of it, I want to talk about two things. I want to talk about the seed, and I want to talk about the soil. The seed, very clearly, is the word of God. The seed is the message of God. Now, the Bible tells us the great power that the message of God has. Paul told us in Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, that the gospel is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, and in it we find the righteousness of God revealed for us. James wrote in James chapter 1 and verse 21 and told us that the word, the message from God, has the power, has the ability to save our souls. There is no denying the power of the word of God. The sharp two-edged sword. The book of Hebrews certainly speaks to us of the great ability and might that the word of God has. Though that is the case, though there is no denying the power of God's word, note in this parable that the seed was only as effective as the soil it fell in allowed it to be. I'll repeat that. The seed was only as effective as the soil it fell in allowed it to be. We'll come back to that. Number two is the soil. The soil is very clearly the heart. If there's any disagreement or misunderstanding about what that was, you go down and look at the words of Jesus himself in verse 19, and it mentions the wicked one comes away and snatches what was sown in his heart. So very clearly the parable is presented to us that the field, all of the different types of soils are the world, all of those who make up the world, that the sower is the Lord, the seed is the message, the word of God, and the soils are the hearts of mankind. What we find then in this parable is there are different hearts, different soils, different types of environments on which God's word falls. Now, if it were only up to the word of God, if an individual's salvation were only up to the word of God, every single soul would be saved because the word has power. But it's not just up to the word of God, because you and I have a choice in our salvation. You and I have a choice in our faithfulness. You and I have a choice of if we come to God, when we come to God, and if we stay there. The word is certainly powerful. But again, the word is only going to produce as much as the soil it falls on, the heart it falls on, allows it to do. So we look at these four different types of hearts. If you want to go down and look at the application that's given, look at verses 18 to 23. In verse 19, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is he who received seed by the wayside. This individual's heart is hard-packed. It's a path that has been walked by thousands of feet. It has been impressed upon by a great weight over a long period of time, and nothing is able to penetrate it. This is the heart of someone that is disinterested in God, someone that is unmoved by God, someone that is unimpressed by what God says, by what God has done for us, and by what God offers. I can't help but also wonder, since this is a hard-pressed way, a hard-pressed soil, a hard-pressed heart, if we might be able to make the application that that seed does not penetrate within the heart because the heart is too full of everything else. Look at the next type of soil, verse 20, 21. But he who receives seed on stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. For when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. One of the things you note as you read the parable of the soils is that all four received the word. Three received the word and did something with it. But only one received the word, did something with it, and kept doing something with it. There's a progression of failure that we see in this particular parable. This stony soul received the word, and it says it received it with joy. It receives it with gladness. It enjoys the message that it was given. Someone who hears the word of God, they hear the plan of salvation spoken to them, they understand the Lord has established his church and has invited them to be a part of it, and they can't wait to go out and start living that life. But after they've made a decision to receive the word, to obey the gospel, and to live life as a Christian, they forget, or they refuse to put down roots. They refuse the nourishment that's there. Now, Jesus talked about water. Remember in John chapter 4, when he met the woman at the well, he talked about living water. And the woman was confused about what Jesus was saying. And she says, well, give me this living water so I don't have to come back and keep drawing, so I don't have to carry these buckets all the way to the well and all the way home, all the way to the well and all the way home. Give me that water now. Jesus is talking about a spring of life, of water that comes up from within the individual, from the abundant life that Jesus is providing through salvation and through the truth, the instruction, and the guidance of the Spirit that he's given us through this word. The nourishment to put down roots, to soak up the nutrients, to soak up the water, that's available. But the person who has this heart or soil of the stony ground, they're living a superficial kind of Christian life. They're living their Christian life just on the surface. Well, they go by the name Christian, they wear the clothes Christian, but they're not putting down roots and actually being a Christian. They're not allowing the word to implant itself permanently within their hearts, and they're not planting themselves purposefully and permanently within the word where the nutrients are going to be found. And because they do not put down roots, what happens? It says when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, immediately they stumble. They are easily uprooted because they've not put anything down to hold on to. That's a superficial type of Christian life. The third soil in verse 22. Now he who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. When you look at the language there, verse 22, I can't help but believe that this is someone who hears the word and they begin to obey the word. It says they become unfruitful. Becoming unfruitful implies at one point, at least originally, they were fruitful. So what happened? Well, they didn't fill enough of their life, enough of their heart, enough of their mind with the nutrients that comes from God's word. They left a space open. When we leave spaces open in our minds, in our hearts, in our souls, if the world has the opportunity, if the devil has the opportunity to fill those spaces, to fill those voids, he will do it every time. First Peter chapter 5 and verse 8 tells us how dangerous he is. It tells us to be sober, be vigilant. Because we have an adversary in the devil who walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Those of this thorny soil, they received the word, they received the message of God, they began to live according to the message of God, but then they allowed distractions and shiny things and cares of the world and lust of the world to become more important to them than the word. Those cares, those distractions, those lusts of the world, those very attractive things in the world around us, they grew up around the seed that was producing and they extinguished what might have grown. And that was the end. Then lastly, in verse 23, you've got that good soil. But he who receives seed on the good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. This is the soil that receives the message of God, that loves the message of God, that implants the message of God as deeply within their hearts as they can. They tell the devil, no matter what happens in life, you can never get me. I belong to God. Nothing is going to keep me from God. They put down strong and deep roots within the Word of God. They push away the distractions of life, and they produce. And they produce and they produce as long as God gives them the opportunity. Those are the different kinds of soils that exist in our world. Those are the different kinds of hearts that we all are. All of us here this morning and all of us in our community around us this morning are one of these different kinds of soils, one of these different kinds of hearts. The sad reality is, according to Jesus in Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, and in verse 21, not everyone will be that good soil. Not everyone will be the soil that takes in the word, that nourishes it, that nourishes their lives by it, that looks for roots, that separates from distraction, that makes a product. Many people, Jesus said, are going to find that broad way, that wide gate. And even of those who claim his name, the Lord says in Matthew 7, 21, that not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Do we not think that soil number 2 and soil number 3 would have mentioned the name of the Lord at some point? And yet soil number 2 and soil number 3 did not reach full maturity. They were snuffed out before the time. Either they withered away because of trial, tribulation, and temptation, or they were choked out by the cares and distractions of the world. So then you and I must be very careful to ensure what type of soil we are while we still have the opportunity to determine what soil we are. When the day of the Lord comes that this world is finished, the soil, the heart, the soul that you and I are at that moment will be locked in. You and I will not have the opportunity to change who we are when that takes place. But up until that time, we don't have to be a particular soil. We're not born a particular type of soil. We're not born with a particular type of heart. You might be thinking about this parable and you might be thinking, well, yeah, I've got some tendencies of soil number 2. Well, that's fine. You can fix that. I've got some tendencies of soil number 3. Well, you can fix that. As long as you have the opportunity in life and this world continues to spin, God allows you the opportunity, the freedom, and in fact appeals to you to change. If you're not the soil, you want and should be. Point number 2, again starts with a P, is a preparation of the soil. The good news is that God wants us all to be that good soil. God wants us all to hear the truth, to have a knowledge of the truth, and to obey the gospel. God has shown us that in writing, 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 4. He wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. And he's shown us that indeed, has he not? John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God has given you and me and the community around us this morning everything that is necessary to be the good soil, to receive the good seed, and to make the good produce. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. His divine power has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Everything we need to be that good soil, to take that good seed, and to make good produce, God's provided for us. I believe that's one of the reasons why the Bible says in James chapter 4, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Why does the Bible tell me I have to draw near to God? Because God has already drawn nearer to you than he should have to begin with. God has already drawn nearer to you than you deserve to start with. God has gone as far as he's going to go. He has given a part of himself, watched his son die for you. He's gone 95% of the way, only asked you to come this last little bit. He's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. He wants us all to be saved. He wants us all to be that good soil. We need a knowledge of the word, of the message, of the seed, before that can produce, do we not? A knowledge of the seed, a knowledge of the message is a prerequisite. You can't find salvation if you don't know who's giving the salvation. You can't find the abundant life if you don't know the Lord that's providing the abundant life. Knowledge is a prerequisite of salvation. But a mere knowledge of God, a mere knowledge of the Lord, a mere knowledge of his plan is not enough to produce good fruit. You have to engage with that word. You have to invest yourself in some personal involvement in your spiritual health, in your spiritual life, in your spiritual future. Knowing something about God's word, knowing the name of the Lord, knowing who the Lord is, owning a Bible, being able to tell people that Jesus Christ is the Son of God is not enough. It's necessary. It's a prerequisite for salvation, but it's not enough to be that good seed that produces 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. For that, you have to engage with the Word and invest in your own development. I cannot improve anybody's spiritual life but my own. Not my kids, not my wife. Well, I can influence people around me positively, but I cannot make the decision to improve someone else's spiritual life. The elders cannot make a decision to improve somebody's spiritual life. You think that there's not individuals that might run through all of our minds that if we could affect somebody's spiritual life and health positively and we could make that decision for them, we would not have already have made that decision? We would not already have dragged somebody down to the front and made sure that they were that good seed? Made sure that they were that good soil that received the good seed and produced? Of course we would, but you and I don't have the power to do that. The individual who hears God's word, who is their own soil, who receives that seed in the soil, it is up to them whether or not they produce. It's up to them what they choose to do with that seed, whether they engage with their Bible or they only use it occasionally and leave it sitting on the shelf most of the time. Whether they allow the contents of that Bible to change their life. That's a decision that that soil, that person, that heart has to make on their own. They have to choose whether or not they engage with God's word or not. We do not accidentally produce good fruit. Turn with me in your New Testaments to 1 Timothy chapter 6. We don't buy a Bible and take it home and wake up the next morning with our life full of spiritual abundance. We do not accidentally attain to the Christian life God has called us to. This life must be pursued. 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning in verse 11, Paul writes to Timothy, "But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness." Timothy was a member of the Lord's church. Timothy was an evangelist in the first century. And even as an evangelist, who we could argue should know the word very well, perhaps know the word more than others, even Paul tells him, pursue righteousness. Seek after it, chase it, capture it. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Verse 12, fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. So look at Timothy. The Bible tells us that Timothy knew the word of God. The Bible tells us that Timothy had great faith. The Bible tells us that Timothy was very dedicated. The Bible tells us that Timothy knew the word of God for a long time. Verse 15 of 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul said, "From childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus." And even to that person who had faith, who had knowledge, who had already shown a habit of obedience and service, even to him, Paul said, pursue righteousness and fight the good fight of faith. Why? Because the day you stop moving forward spiritually is the day you begin to atrophy and go backwards. The day you stop going forwards, the day you stop growing, the day you stop looking, the day you stop trying to attain to higher heights of spiritual health is the day you begin to decay spiritually. Of all of the knowledge that Paul had, of all of the willingness that Paul possessed to serve the Lord, of all of Paul's life that he had given of himself, when we think about examples in the New Testament of individuals that we could say had great faith, that were pillars of faith, that were great examples of good, strong, godly Christians, we might think of Paul, right? We might think of Peter, we might think of Apollos, we might think of John, but quite frequently when we think about who is one of the greatest characters in the New Testament, outside of Jesus, who is one of the greatest characters in the New Testament, we think, well, Paul, all that Paul had done, all that Paul had been. But you know what even Paul said? "Brethren, I do not count myself to have attained. What do? I forget the things that are behind, reach forward to the things which are ahead, so that I might press for the mark to the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." So that means even after all that Paul had done, Paul was still working. Paul was still growing. Paul was still attaining. Paul was still looking to improve. You and I do not accidentally stumble upon spiritual health. We've got to pursue it. Though that's true, though that step that Paul gave to Timothy was necessary, it was not the first step. I want you to turn back with me all the way to your Old Testament, to the book of Ezra. Ezra chapter 7. We're just going to look at a couple of verses here. We're almost finished this morning. Ezra chapter 7, verse 1. "Now after these things, in the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, Ezra, the son of Sariah, the son of Azariah, the son of Hilkiah," and there's a bunch more people listed, go down to verse 6. "This Ezra came up from Babylon, and he was a skilled scribe in the law of Moses." I want you to note what it says about who Ezra was. "He was a skilled scribe in the law of Moses, which the Lord God of Israel had given. The king granted him all his requests according to the hand of the Lord his God upon him. Some of the children of Israel, the priests, the Levites, the singers, the gatekeepers, and the Nethinim, came up to Jerusalem in the 7th year of King Artaxerxes. And Ezra came to Jerusalem in the 5th month, which was in the 7th year of the king. On the first day of the month, he began his journey from Babylon. And on the first day of the 5th month, he came to Jerusalem, according to the good hand of his God upon him." Now look at what verse 10 says. "For Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord, and to do it, and to teach statutes and ordinances in Israel." Pursuing righteousness, fighting that good fight of faith that Paul told Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 11 and 12 to do, those are necessary steps in the life of one who is fruitful for God. But it's not the first step. We could argue the first step is found in Ezra chapter 7 and verse 10. Ezra prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. What do you need to do when you plant something? You just go outside, throw a handful of seed in the backyard, hope it's going to work? Or do you attempt to prepare the soil that you're about to put this seed in? God's seed has power. God's seed has the ability to save our souls. God's message has the ability to save our souls. But we have the responsibility to prepare our soil so that when that seed hits it, it produces. So that as that seed continues to grow within it, it will continue to produce. Preparing our soil, weeding out that which is unnecessary, maintaining and nourishing our soil as this message creates fruit that begins to grow in our life. That's not a one-time only process. The Hebrews writer in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 said, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we let them slip. The idea is that they drift away as a boat from the dock that has not been tied down. If you have taken in the Word of God, if you have taken in God's message and it has begun to produce fruit in your life, but you become distracted with other things and it's been brought down on the priority list, that message will be like a boat that you didn't tie up. And over time, the waves will just take that message further and further away until you can't see it anymore and it's not a part of your life. The point I'm making by that explanation from Hebrews chapter 2 is whether it is the first time you're receiving God's message, or it is the 500th time you are receiving God's message, we all have a responsibility to prepare our soil to be the good soil and to maintain our soil so that it remains the good soil. That's the produce. Now we have opportunities. We have choices to make in our life. We can be like the wayside soil. That's hard packed. We can hear the word of God, let it pass through one ear, out the other. We can walk out the doors. We can never think about this message again. That's not what God wants you to do, but God will allow you to do it if that's what you choose to do. You can hear the message of God, and you can begin to obey it. You can begin to live it, but you can live a superficial type of Christian life where you don't actually dig down deep. You don't invest yourself in God's word. You don't invest yourself in God's family. You don't invest yourself in the work of the church. You are a Sunday morning Christian sometimes. You can, if you so choose, take the word of God, begin to produce, but then allow things in your life to start to get in the way. You allow things that are shiny and have great attraction in life to start to grow closer and closer to you. And you open the door and you allow them to get closer and closer and closer to you. Before you know, those things, the world, are closer to you than God is. And they're more important to you than God is. Now, God does not want you to be either one of those first three soils. But if you so choose, He will let you be those soils. The Word has a power to save your soul. But you've got to agree to it. Or you can be that last soil. A soil that hears the word of God, loves it, permanently implants it within your heart, encapsulates it within who you are as your very being. You put down roots into God's word, study to show yourself approved. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. You find out what God wants for you and from you, and you willingly give that to God by your activities. You open up the word and you invest yourself in that word. And you allow it so that you are firmly planted in God's word, steadfast and unmovable, 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 58. You ensure that the distractions and the cares and all of the attractive things in life, all of those sins and weights that can so easily carry us down, that you separate yourself from those things. Put as much distance between yourselves and those things as possible, Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 to 9. Paul in that section is telling even those who are already Christians, remove these things from your life. Why? Because in the very first part of chapter 3, he said, if you are risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Why? Because you can't serve the world and God. You've got a decision to make. And then lastly, you can continually invest yourself in this pursuit of righteousness and allow God to make increase in your life. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6 and 7, Paul wrote to the church in Corinth and said that he and Apollos were nothing. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but it is God who gives the increase. Which soil, heart, type of soul are you this morning? If you're not the right type of soul, you can fix that. If you're not the right type of soil, you can fix that. You have the opportunity to hear God's message this morning and allow it to impact the way that you're living your life. God has invited all of us to come to Him because, as I mentioned earlier, God wants all of us to be saved. God invites us to hear His word and to believe it, to repent of our past sins, to tell God we're going to live how He wants us to live from now on and not how we've lived in the past, to confess Jesus as the Son of God, as the Christ and the Savior, to be baptized for the forgiveness of our sins, being placed into that kingdom, being placed into His body, living a life that is faithful according to His words until the world ends or our life ends. If we are faithful unto death, then we'll receive that crown of life, Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10. If you've not done that this morning, don't put it off and wait until it's too late. If you have already done it this morning, but there's something in your life that is not right with God, if you need to adjust something about your life to ensure you are the soil that you need to be, you have the opportunity to pray to God on your own behalf for that. You don't need to come forward and have the church pray for you, but we are willing to pray for you if you would like the assistance. You have that freedom to go to God and to tell God you've not been who you should be. You've not given all that you could be. You've not made the roots in His word like you should have. You have that freedom to pray to God for that this morning if you need to before you leave. And if you would like the church to pray with you and for you, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender all. To Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His present daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all to Him, blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. To Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior wholly Thine. Let me fill the Holy Spirit to know that Thou art mine. I surrender all. I surrender all. Savior, I surrender all to I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy loving power. Let thy blessing fall on me. I surrender, oh, I surrender, oh, to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender, oh.
Please be seated. Before the taking of the Lord's table, number 279, we'll sing verses 1 and 2. 1 and 2.
Why did my Savior come to earth and to the humble go? Why did he choose a lonely bird? Because he loved me so. He loved me so. He loved me so. He gave his precious life for me, because he loved me so. Why did he drink the bitter cup of sorrow, pain, and woe? Why, on the cross be lifted up, because he loved me so. He loved me so. He loved me so. His precious life for me, because he loved me so.
If you do not have a communion packet, raise your hand and one will be brought to you. I'll be reading Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 29. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, please bless the bread, which is your Son's body, which is broken on the cross of Calvary, dear Lord, so that we may be saved, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us pray for the cup. Dear Heavenly Father, bless the fruit of the vine, which is your Son's blood, which was shed for the remission of our sins, dear Lord, so that we may go to heaven someday with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Number 87. 87.
I'm not ashamed to own my Lord, nor to defend his call. Maintain the honor of his word, the glory of the cross. Firm as his throne, his promise then, and he can well secure what I've committed to his hand, the decisive vow. Then will he hold my worthless name before his Father's face. And in the New Jerusalem, appoint for me a place.
We now come to a part of our service, which is the collection or the offering. We find reference on how much or how when we're supposed to give. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 1 and 2. Bible says, now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye, that upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God has prospered him, that there be no gathering when I come. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 8, teaches us how we should give. He which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. And he which sows bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every one of you, as you have purposed in your heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. The money that is taken up each first day of the week is used for evangelism, maintaining the faith of the faithful, and also helping the needy in our community. So at this time, let us bow and ask prayer for our offerings. Heavenly Father, we can't outgive you, for you've given the ultimate to mankind, your Son Jesus Christ, who came in the form of a human being, but lived a life without sin, gave his life for us so that we may have a chance to be with you forever. We ask that as we give each first day of the week, that we would do it with the willing mind, knowing that the money is used for the works that you've given the church through your Son, Jesus Christ. And we ask, Father, that you always be with us, not only in our giving of money, but giving ourselves to the work of the church. We ask this prayer in your Son Christ's name. Amen. If you would like to give, as you go out the double doors, there's a white box on the table. Please give cheerfully. Thank you very much.
We truly thank each and every one of you for being here today, and we pray that you would be back with us on the next appointed time. And we want to give a special greeting to those of our who are with us who are visitors today. If you have time, stay around and let us get to know you better. Our closing hymn will be Sanctuary. Let's stand together and sing this song together.
Oh Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary.
poor and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, teach your children to stop the fighting, start uniting all as one. Let's get together forever, sanctuary for you. And when he comes with shouts of glory, and our work on earth is done, oh, how I long for him to tell me, faithful servant, well done.
Let us bow, please. Our Father in heaven, we are truly thankful again that you have allowed us to see another day. It is you, Father, that we live, move, and have our own being. Without you, Father, this wouldn't be possible. We're thankful, Father, that we have gathered ourselves together and that we have embraced and encouraged one toward the other, and that we demonstrated our love toward each other. But most importantly, that we come here to work out our soul's salvation with fear and trembling. We are thankful, Father, for the message that was rendered by Brother Phil. And we pray, Father, that we take heed to those words of inspiration that is able to save men's soul. We pray, Father, that we didn't allow anything to distract us from hearing your word, and to obey it and apply it. To our guests, our friends, and our neighbors, we pray, Father, that we have extended our love toward them and that they felt comfortable. But let them know that we speak the truth and abide by only the truth. And we pray, Father, that if there's anyone that is here that is not a member of the true church, we pray, Father, that they tarry not too long, for they don't know what holds for tomorrow. Today could be even their last day. Tomorrow could be their last day. We pray, Father, that they search themselves and understand that their soul salvation is in jeopardy. And we pray, Father, that we have said all things according to the truth, and that nothing was said that was in vain or unscripture. We're thankful and we pray as we prepare ourselves to depart from this building that you will allow us, Father, to arrive to our home safely. Let us not forget those that are not with us, those that are sick, those that may be traveling, those in nursing homes, and those that have strayed away. Let us continue to work hard and strive to gain our brothers and sisters in Christ, and that we continue to preach the truth that all that may obey the truth. We ask it in thy Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen.